I will go ahead and start our colloquium for today. So we have 5 talks today by students in the theory group at the Paul Allen School. I am super excited to see a wide range of talks today. You'll get to see a sample of all the different things that the theory group does. So first up, we have Nathan Klein. Nathan, you can share and start whenever you're ready. I hope you saw Nathan's abstract when the emails came out. He has the most precise abstract I have ever seen, and I do hope that he will share more with you on that during his talk. It's called Approximating the Metric Traveling Salesperson Problem. Go ahead, Nathan.
Thanks, Robbie. I'm gonna be talking about the Metric Traveling Salesperson Problem, or TSP, which I've been working on recently with Anna Carlin and Shaina Mies-Grahn, my advisors. So what is metric TSP? Say I give you a set of cities and their pairwise distances, which we assume are symmetric, so they're the same in both directions. Then TSP asks you to find the shortest tour, which visits every city at least once, and then returns to the starting city. So what I've drawn would be a valid tour. And actually, this would also be a valid tour, even though it's more expensive. So any connected graph where every vertex has even degree is valid, since such a graph has a so-called Eulerian tour. So basically we're looking for a minimum cost graph, which is connected and in which every vertex has even degree. So this is the same problem. And unfortunately, TSP is NP-hard. So in many cases, we won't be able to actually find the optimal tour in polynomial time, you know, unless P equals NP. So what do we do when faced with these problems, say in the real world? And one thing you might try is to relax the condition that we get the optimal solution. So in the field of approximation algorithms, we do exactly this, and we try to design fast algorithms that maybe don't find the optimal solution, but sort of at least get close. You might ask, what's the point of this? And basically there are 2 answers. So the one we usually tell our friends is that, well, NP hard problems are pretty common in the real world, and so it's important to have tools that let us get decent solutions to these problems. And this is completely valid, and approximation algorithms really are used in the real world, and so it's good to push the envelope here for sure. However, I think a lot of us in the field have a kind of secret math reason, which is we want to know sort of why these problems are hard. So sometimes we can get fast algorithms that are within a fraction of a percent of optimal. So in the real world, these problems are basically solvable. But sometimes we can't get anything even within a factor of 100 or 1,000 of the optimal or something. And so basically we want to know sort of what's going on here mathematically and what structures in the problem arise which make it easy or hard. And so for TSP, the best approximation algorithm has been a 1.5 approximation, meaning it always returns a tour at most 50% longer than the optimal one. And this is from the 70s, and it's known as Christofides' algorithm. And sort of on the other hand, we know that unless P equals NP, we can't find algorithms that get within about 1% of optimal. So this problem is not very well understood. And we'd really like to know whether the true answer is closer to this 50% or 1%. And I think probably both theoreticians and practitioners are interested in this question. 50% could be a lot of extra miles, but 1% is probably fine. So we've been stuck on this 50% barrier sort of since the 70s, and I found a meme about this last year. And I started thinking about this problem with Anne and Cheyenne 2 years ago. And I'm sad to say we didn't, we tried, but we didn't achieve Boromir's goal. However, we did actually beat 50%. We showed that we can get 50% minus a tiny constant. So, many more nines than Boromir wanted. And I wrote the map for you, in case you wanted to see. So we showed that there's 1.5 minus 10 to the negative 36 approximation algorithm. So it's better, but he's still not happy. So we'll have to keep trying. And just sort of in case you think we sound insane, which we might be, I don't know, I want to be clear that, you know, this result is partially about introducing new techniques that might be applicable elsewhere, but it's also about breaking a kind of psychological barrier more than anything. So we're really we were stuck with this old algorithm for a long time, and now we know there's something at least a little better. So part of the point is to give people hope that there's an algorithm that's much better than 50% and sort of inspire people to look for it. So I want to tell you a little bit about what we did. And to do that, first, I want to show you the old algorithm, Christofides' algorithm. So here's an example graph we might want to find a TSP tour on. And in general, there are sort of weights on the edges, which correspond to the distances between the cities. But here, maybe think of each edge as having weight one. And then the distance between two cities is given by the shortest path between those two endpoints. Okay, so what's the algorithm? First, you choose a minimum spanning tree T, and this makes the graph connected. However, since there are odd vertices, this doesn't correspond to a tour. So if I was trying to go along these green edges and make a tour, I'd be stuck because if I tried to go here, I'd also have to leave it. And there's no other edge. So basically every vertex should have even degree. So to fix this, we add the minimum cost matching on the odds be vertices of the tree, and this makes every vertex even. Okay, so this gives us a tour, so that's, it works. And now let's look at how much it costs. So, you know, it's the sum of the cost of the tree and the cost of the matching. And since opt itself is a tree plus an edge, the cost of a minimum spanning tree is definitely at most opt. So, you know, this part is not too expensive. And now let's look at the cost of the matching. So I claim it's at most half the cost of opt. And to see this, consider the odd vertices of the tree along the best possible TSP tour. So I've highlighted the odd vertices in red. And it's not hard to see that the restriction of the optimal cycle to these odd vertices costs at most opt again. So you're just sort of, you know, shortcutting these vertices here. And there are actually an odd number of odd vertices. So you can partition this subtour into two matchings. So I have one in purple and one in pink. And therefore, the cheaper one must cost at most half of opt. And therefore, a minimum cost matching costs at most half of opt because I could have just used one of these matchings. So this proves the claim. And together you get a 3/2 approximation. So this didn't make sense, that's fine. It's just, you know, the cost of the matching is at most half of opt. And if you want to follow this general framework, basically you want to get a tree and then add a matching, and you want to improve it, it basically boils down to finding a better tree. So the problem with Christofides' algorithm is that it might pick a spanning tree that makes the matching really expensive. So remember, we add the minimum cost matching on the odd vertices of the tree. Well, we can find examples where Christofides' algorithm picks a tree where every vertex is odd. So like this tree here. And that's not good. We have to find now a matching which fixes every single vertex, and this will probably cost a lot. Okay, so that's bad. But in the real world, you know, you often find trees that look more like this. And this is basically a better shape. A lot of these vertices, for example, are even. So they wouldn't need to be in the matching. So this suggests the question, what about random trees? Sort of, you know, want them to look like nature, so what about random trees? It's a bit tricky to define what random even means here, but in 2010, Cheyenne and Sabarian Singh came up with basically a good definition of random. And to make a long story short, we showed that their definition of random trees actually leads to trees with cheap matchings. So the random tree will cost the most opt, and then we showed that the matching will be a little bit cheaper than opt over two. And basically, we showed that these trees have a nice, let's say, shape on average, and that translates to a small gain. And although we could only prove a small improvement, we think the algorithm might be much better, like even as good as 4/3. So the main open question, which we're thinking about, you know, a little, but hopefully others will think about more, is whether this analysis can be greatly improved. And yeah, we're hopeful that someone will come along with an exciting new idea. So yeah, thanks for listening. Here's a picture of some TSP soup. And I think we're doing questions at the end. So let the next person go.
Yes, we will do questions at the end. So let's thank Nathan visually as best we can over Zoom. And then our next speaker, Ansh, can go ahead and start screen sharing when you're ready. Yes, if you have any questions, go ahead and put them into chat. And then I will assemble those and ask our speakers at the end. All right, our next speaker is going to be Ansh Nagda, and he's going to talk about near linear size hypergraph cut sparsifiers. Go ahead, Ansh.
Okay, thanks, Ravi. So yeah, this is work that I did with Yu Chen and Sanjeev Khanna on this really cool problem called hypergraph cut sparsification. So let's start. So hopefully everyone has seen something like this before. It's a graph. And we can try to represent this graph in a slightly different way. So instead of drawing a line between two edges or between two vertices of an edge, maybe we can just draw a curve that encloses these two vertices. And this is actually an example of something that we call a hypergraph. So what is a hypergraph? Well, it's a certain generalization of a graph. So as we saw in the previous slide, every graph is also a hypergraph, but there exist hypergraphs that are not graphs. So what I mean by this is that we kind of relax the condition on edges. So an edge now no longer has to contain just two vertices. It can contain any number of vertices. So if you see the example on the bottom right, there is a purple edge and an orange edge, which contain like four and three vertices, respectively. So this is kind of an example of hypergraph that's not also a graph. Okay, and these are basically the objects that we work with during this work. And a couple of notes is that we allow edges to have weights, non-negative weights, and the default weight of an edge is always one. And there is like an important distinction between hypergraphs and graphs in that hypergraphs can have up to 2 to the n edges. Because think of the case where every subset of vertices is an edge in your hypergraph. That's going to give you 2 to the n edges. But for standard graphs, the maximum number of edges is about n squared. So so hypergraphs can be much, much bigger than standard graphs. Okay. So given a hypergraph, a cut is just a partitioning of the vertices into two parts. Okay, and we say that an edge crosses a cut if it has a vertex in both parts of this cut. So if you look at the example at the bottom, there's like this blue line that divides the set of vertices into S and S bar, which is the vertices on the top and vertices on the bottom of the blue line. Yeah, and the edges that cross this cut are simply the red edges, because all of the red edges have one vertex on each side. But the black edge in this graph, in this hypergraph, has both edges on the same side of this cut. So the black edge does not cross this cut. Okay, and the last piece of notation that I should define is it's the value of a cut in a graph or in a hypergraph. So the value of a cut just counts the total weight of edges that cross the cut. So in this example, only the red edges cross the cut. There's three of them. So the value of this cut is 3. Okay, and now we should be ready to define what problem we are trying to solve. So the problem of hypergraph sparsification is that given an input hypergraph H, can we find another hypergraph H prime such that the value of every cut in H prime is approximately the same as its value in H? And by approximately, let's just say it's like about 1% error. Okay, and this kind of condition, you can see that it's captured by this inequality at the bottom. Okay, and the goal of this problem is to find such a sparsifier H prime with as few edges as possible. Okay, so let's just look at a toy kind of non-example of a sparsifier. So if the input hypergraph H is the hypergraph that we were looking at before, okay, and let's say H prime just contains one of these edges, but the weight of that edge has been scaled up to 3. Okay, let's see whether it preserves the value of every cut. So let's just pick a cut arbitrarily. So for this cut, we already saw that the value of H is over 3. And clearly the value of this cut in H prime is also over 3. So so far it's kind of preserving this cut. But if we look at a different cut, well, the value on the left is now 4, but the value on the right is still 3. So this is H prime. It's a non-example of a sparsifier of H. Okay, and in general, this should kind of make it clear that it's not easy to prove that a hypergraph is a sparsifier of another hypergraph, because you have to kind of check simultaneously for every cut that its value is preserved. So this can be pretty tricky to prove. So let's look at some of the prior work and the result that we achieved. So one thing that I will not explain too much is like a lower bound on the size of a sparsifier. So this follows from the fact that every connected graph has at least n minus 1 edges. So actually the best we can hope for is that the hypergraph sparsifier has about at least n edges in the worst case. Okay, so n is like the it's like the bound that is the best possible bound. Okay, so in 1996, Bengzer and Karger studied this problem for the special case where the input is a standard graph. Okay, and they were able to design an algorithm to compute sparsifiers containing about n log n edges. And notice that n log n is pretty close to the theoretical lower bound of n edges. And in 2014, this problem was also studied in the case of any hypergraph as the input. And it was proved that we can compute sparsifiers of any hypergraph that contains only that contain only about n squared edges. And the motivation of our work was, can we reduce this n squared down to n log n to match the Bengzer and Karger's bound for any hypergraph? And that's what we proved. So that is our result. Let me tell you a bit about how all of these algorithms work. They all actually follow a pretty similar high-level plan, where the first step is like they compute a probability value for every edge. Okay, and they use this probability value to subsample H into a graph H prime. What I mean by this is that every edge is included in the graph H prime with this probability value PE. Okay, and after you add an edge to H prime, you also have to scale its weight by a factor of 1 over PE. I won't get too much into why this is the case, but it's just kind of to preserve the expected size of expected value of cuts in H prime. So basically, the only thing that remains to specify is how exactly these probability values are calculated. Okay, and recall that what we want to prove is two things. Firstly, we want to prove that the probability values that we find lead to a sparsifier of H with high probability. And the second thing we want to prove is that the expected number of edges in our sparsifier is about n log n. Okay, so that's actually exactly what the work of Bengzer and Karger in 96 did. So they proved that in the case that the input is a graph, we can assign probability values in a way that satisfies both properties simultaneously. Okay, and the main idea behind this this proof is that cuts behave like really well in standard graphs. What I mean by this is that there are explicit bounds on the behavior of cuts in standard graphs that are really desirable. So one can think of how to extend this Bengzer and Karger's result from standard graphs to hypergraphs, but this is doesn't seem to be so easy to do. It's because these bounds that we had for cuts and graphs, they actually do not hold for hypergraphs. So the corresponding bounds that we get for hypergraphs are much, much worse. So it doesn't seem that easy to extend Bengzer and Karger's idea to general hypergraphs. So the main idea we had in this work was maybe we can define a standard graph G that somehow acts as a proxy for H. Okay, and we know that G must have like really well-behaved cuts because graphs have well-behaved cuts. So maybe we can use G to analyze the behavior of our algorithm for the hypergraph H. Okay, so the question is, how do we go from H, which is a hypergraph, to G, which is a standard graph? Okay, so here is like a really straightforward idea. Maybe we can replace each edge in the hypergraph with a clique on its vertex. So maybe if the edge has size 4 in this example, you replace it with four choose two edges. Okay, and then you maybe you can think of dividing the weight of E equally among all of these four choose two edges. Okay, and that leads to a construction for a standard graph G. Okay, so actually what we need to consider to make this whole thing work is a more general way to construct the graph G. So actually we can let every edge E choose how they want to divide their weight among its key. So for example, this edge E can choose whether it wants to divide its weight equally or whether it wants to use some other unequal division of weight among its clique. Okay, so this is basically a general method to construct the graph, like the proxy graph G from the input hypergraph. Okay, and our approach is, can we use the Bengtzer-Karger's algorithm on graphs to compute the probabilities of edges in this graph G? And maybe we can use the probabilities in this graph G to kind of compute some other probabilities for the original hypergraph H. Okay, so this is like our first attempt. So maybe we can just set the probability for edge E to be the sum of probabilities of the edges in its clique. Okay, and it turns out that this attempt gives us property one for free, but it might not satisfy property two. Sorry, I mean the other way around. It gives us property two for free, but it might not satisfy property one. And we also had a second attempt where the probability for the edge E is given by this other expression. And this we can prove using the like nice cut properties for the graph G that this always gives us property one, but maybe it does not give us property two. Okay. So just assume for now that somehow it is true that for every edge, attempts one and two, they both lead to the same probability values. Okay. Then actually we can use the argument for attempt one to prove property two and the argument for attempt two to prove property one. So, but this is like a very ideal case. Like there is no reason to expect that the probabilities, that the attempts one and two both lead to the same probability values. So there's actually a way to solve this. So if you remember, we have not specified how exactly we can compute G from the G, which is the proxy graph from H. There was still some ambiguity on how each edge decides to assign its weight to its clique. So the main technical part of our work is providing this algorithm to compute some graph G, meaning to assign the weight of each edge to its clique in some way, such that both the attempts lead to the same probability values. Okay, and if we use the same argument as before, this is enough to prove that both properties hold simultaneously. Okay. So here is the final algorithm that results when you put all of this together. So first we can use this algorithm from the main technical part to compute this proxy graph G. Okay, and next we can use Bengtzer and Karger's algorithm to calculate probability values for G. Okay, and these probability values lead to probability values for the hypergraph H. That are defined by these attempts one and two. Like both of them will give you the same probability for hypergraph H. So once we compute these probability values for H, we can just follow the rest of the plan in exactly the same way as the other algorithms. In particular, you subsample H prime using these probability values and the output H prime will satisfy both properties that we want. So yeah, that is what we proved, and that's all I had for you today. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Ansh. Our next speaker is going to be Swati Padmanabhan. Swati, if you can go ahead and share, awesome. So we've seen so far graphs and hypergraphs. We are going to take a hard left turn and talk about a very different type of theoretical computer science. Swati is going to tell us about a faster interior point method for semi-definite programming. Go ahead, Swati.
Okay, thanks, Robbie. Hi, everyone. My name is Swati, and I'm going to be presenting a recent work on a faster interior point method for semi-definite programming. This is joint work with Haotian Jiang, Tarun Kathuria, Yintat Lee, and Zhao Song. So let's first start with the definition of a semi-definite program, which is abbreviated as SDP usually. You're given as your input the following matrices. There is a cost matrix C, which is n by n in dimensions. And you have these constraint matrices, A1 through AM, all of which are also n by n in size. And let's just assume they're all symmetric matrices. You're further given a vector B, which is an m-dimensional space. So with all this input, here's our problem. You wish to find a matrix X, which is also n by n in size, and satisfies the properties that it's positive semi-definite, and it satisfies all these M equalities. And once it satisfies all these conditions, we want it to be the feasible X that maximizes this particular objective. And I'm gonna now explain what all these symbols mean. So AI dot X equals BI. This dot here is the inner product between these two matrices. Now you might remember from vector lambda, we say the inner product of A and B is simply, you know, you take this vector A, you take this vector B, and you multiply them entry wise, and then you add them up. That's the inner product of those two vectors. The inner product of two matrices is just defined the exact same way. So you take this matrix, you take this other matrix, and you sort of open it up, and you multiply them entry wise, and you add them up. So that's what this dot here means. This symbol here means that X is positive semi-definite, which means it has to be symmetric. And it also has to satisfy the property that all its eigenvalues are non-negative. Now, you might have seen this problem, but without this last constraint, and those are linear programs. But when you have this PSD constraint here, that's a non-linear constraint. So semi-definite programs are in fact generalizations of linear programs. And they have a lot of applications. So they've found applications in control theory, in very classical electrical engineering. But in our side of the field, in theoretical computer science, they're used in finding better approximation ratios for very classical NP-hard problems. So approximation ratio is what Nathan explained in his talk of, a few minutes ago. And so in 1995, for example, the first time we got this, we got a very good approximation ratio for max cut using SDPs. So they are very important. And in this project, our goal is to solve any SDP to epsilon accuracy for very small epsilon. And what do I mean by this statement, solve this problem to epsilon accuracy? It means I want to find a matrix X that's feasible and which satisfies the property that its objective value is at most epsilon worse than the true optimum. And when I say epsilon worse, I mean in the additive sense. So that's the goal here. And know that here we care about epsilon being extremely small, so exponentially small. So there are several different kinds of algorithms for SDPs, but when you are in the regime where epsilon is extremely small, you want the runtime to be logarithmic in 1/epsilon. And to achieve this goal, we have two classical algorithms at our disposal. One is called the cutting plane method. And as the name suggests, here's how it works. You start with a big convex set that is guaranteed to contain the optimum somewhere. And the goal is to get to this optimum. And in each iteration, you do some kind of query, typically a gradient query, and you cut this, this set that contains the optimum into half, for example. And now you have this smaller set that contains the optimum. Sorry, it doesn't go that small. It was just my tablet drawing skills. But yeah, so in each iteration, you have a query and you slowly, you know, reduce the size of the set and you zero in on your optimum. So that's the cutting plane method. The interior point method works in a pretty different way. So suppose the function that you wish to minimize is this, and you have some constraint set. Then you take that constraint set and you encode it in the form of this, what we call a barrier function. Basically, it's a barrier to violating the constraints. It makes sure you don't get out of the constraint set. And you have this scaling factor eta, which it's like a knob that you adjust. And in each iteration, you solve this extremely well-defined optimization problem. So notice the contrast between the two algorithms. In the cutting plane method, in each iteration, the only information that you have is that your opt lies in some set. In the interior point method, you have a lot more information. You have this extremely explicit formulation, and you know that the optimum, you know, satisfies what we call a bunch of optimality conditions, which you can actually write down. So there's a lot more information about your optimum in each iteration in the interior point method, as opposed to the cutting plane method. And so given the nature of these two algorithms, for any problem class, the expectation is that the interior point method has to be faster, right? If you know a lot more about the optimum in this case, then of course it has to be faster. But the interesting thing is that before our work, for the case of SDPs, cutting planes were faster. And what I mean here is they were theoretically faster. We only talk about theoretical things here. So before our work, cutting plane methods were faster. And so the goal of our project was to try and resolve this paradox, right? Interior point methods should be faster. They are not. Can we fix this? And in this paper, we actually do achieve this goal. So I'll just go briefly over what does an interior point method look like? What did we do to be this cutting plane thing? Okay. So we start with our problem. We write the dual problem, and it's just something that you obtain by, you know, following a bunch of rules. And you do this because the problem size is much smaller in the dual space, because the problem size here equals the number of constraints in the primal setting. Okay, and then this is the constraint set. And as I mentioned, you have this barrier function. So now this barrier function will encode these constraints. So now you have an unconstrained optimization problem. Once you have this, in each iteration, you change the eta a little bit. So you start with eta being extremely small. So you start at the minimizer of just this guy, but you increase eta a little bit, and then you solve the resulting optimization problem. And so iteratively changing eta will solve a new optimization problem in each step, which leads to a situation that looks something like this, right? You start at the center of your set, and you're slowly heading to the optimizer, okay? So in our setting, for the SDP that we are talking about, remember our objective function looks something like this. It's eta times b transpose y minus log det of this slack matrix. So I'm not going to go into the details here, just a high level. So this was the eta update step, and this is the solving the new problem by Newton method. And if you actually compute the quantities, if you actually compute this Hessian and the gradient, these are how they look. And the thing I wish to emphasize is that in each iteration, the most expensive step is computing the Hessian, okay? And so our modification is the following. We, instead of using the original slack matrix, the original S, what we do is we construct this approximate slack matrix, S tilde. And S tilde satisfies this property that it's roughly close to S. If you're not going to use S, then you better use something that's almost S, right? Otherwise, you're not going to be correct at all. But then we also remember that the solving, like computing these Hessian entries, was very expensive. So how do we ensure that S tilde is such that the Hessian computation is cheaper? The way we do that is, not only does S tilde satisfy this property that it's roughly close to the true slack, but it also satisfies the property that it does not change too much. Okay, so in each, going from one iteration to the next, since S tilde does not change that much, we can prove that these entries can be updated very cheaply. Okay, and that is the whole game. You maintain something which is close enough to the true thing, but also doesn't change much. So the thing that you wish to compute can be updated cheaply. And just because I want to show the lemma, we proved this is the lemma, and this is the main lemma that shows the change is not too high, and this is our final theorem. That's all I want to say. Thank you so much for your attention.
If folks have questions for any of our speakers, please do put them in the chat. I will assemble those and ask our speakers at the end once we have time. Our next speaker though is going to be Victor Hayes. Victor, you can share screen whenever you're ready. He's going to talk about an elementary exposition of Pisier's inequality, and probably correct me on the name of that mathematician. Go ahead, Victor.
Hey guys, I'm going to talk about some work I did with my advisor and a few other people this summer. And here's a brief motivation. And if there's anything you get from this talk, this is like a pretty cool result. It's basically what got me interested in convex geometry. It's that any convex set, you can always transform it such that it includes the unit ball, and it's included in a ball that's m times larger if it's in m dimensions. For example, this triangle here in two dimensions, it contains a circle, and it's contained in a circle that's two times larger in radius. So that's pretty cool. There's one issue though, is that this m factor is kind of large. So it's tight for the simplex. So if you have a simplex in m dimension, which is basically like a generalization of the triangle, you can't do better than m. And in some situations in computer science, there are situations in which you really want to do better than m. So here in this case, for example, in the simplex, it's actually much closer to the square root m ball than to either ball that is included or that includes it. So if you just care about the volume, for example, then the volume of the ball of radius square root m is actually the same approximately as the volume of the triangle. So you can ask, okay, how can we do better in some sense? And there's some way we can measure how pointy the set is. So like the triangle is much pointier than the ball. And if we measure the pointiness, you can actually do better by a factor of square root log actually. So like the kind of width of the ball in some sense, it's square root m, and the width of the triangle is square root m times log m. And you can ask whether you can do better than this. And like the idea is that if the volume is one, then the width is always at least the square root of the dimension, and that's tight for a ball. But for the triangle here, there's a square root log factor, and that's actually almost tight. So in general, you know that for any convex set, you can always transform it linearly such that it only pays a factor of log compared to the ball. And the main tool that is used for this is this thing called Pisier's inequality that I'm going to briefly talk about. So I won't actually explain what Pisier's inequality is, but here's like a brief motivation about why a computer science student is thinking about geometry problems. You can actually compute volumes of convex bodies deterministically up to an approximation factor that is basically tight. And there's also some other cool stuff that we can do with this, but you probably don't care about it, so I won't mention. So the main high-level idea of Pisier's inequality is that every function on the hypercube is not much larger than its linear term for some notion of linear term. And to be more precise, and you probably won't understand this, but I just want to be precise, is that the linear term is always at most like a log factor of the function in some sense. And here, you don't need to know what this means, but I just want to write out what the linear term actually means. And we also show a matching lower bound up to a factor of log log. And the main part of our proof is we have this nice filter that filters out linear terms of functions. And here's what I mean by this. It's a self-contained thing, so I just want to show this quickly. That there's a function for every odd number L. We can always construct a function in one dimension, so there's no more m-dimensional stuff going on. You can always construct a one-dimensional function whose integral is zero in the interval from one to minus one, and whose integral of the absolute value is small. Well, this is actually easy. You can just take f equals zero. But there are a few other constraints. So we want to filter the linear term. So we want the integral of x to be one, and we also want to zero out the higher order terms up to L. And actually, the zero function doesn't work anymore because you want the integral of x to be one. And actually, this was already known before our work, but we were the first to provide an actual example of a function that works. So previously, it was only known existentially that it exists, but nobody actually wrote it down. So here's the example. If I didn't scare you enough, it looks something like this. And actually, this is not exactly true because it diverges the integral. So we actually need to discretize and reparameterize it to make it work. And I'm not going to explain much about this. I'm just going to quickly skip through some slides of high school trigonometry that prove this result. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you, Victor. And thank you for not making us relive high school trigonometry. I don't think even theoreticians like reliving that. All right. Our next and final speaker is going to be Ewin Tang. So Ewin, you can go ahead and screen share whenever you're ready. Awesome. Ewin is going to talk about an improved quantum-inspired algorithm for linear regression. Go ahead, Ewin.
Hi. I'm going to be talking about this paper. This paper is in the field of it's related to the field of quantum machine learning. Usually I put a list of papers in quantum machine learning here just to show that people care about it, but I can assume that you could probably guess why quantum machine learning is a hot topic. This is Google Quantum's website, and it gives a list of their potential applications for investigating or building quantum computers. And you can see one of these is quantum machine learning right here. So basically it's like, if quantum computers could speed up machine learning tasks, and obviously it would lead to a lot of faster algorithms, a lot better machine learning in the long run. And if you look at what quantum computers can, in theory, do, or like in look at the algorithms that are being proposed for linear algebra type tasks, these actually are pretty promising. So there are a lot of algorithms that talk about how quantum computers, were we to build one that's good enough, we're very far from that right now, but in the far future, when we have quantum computers, they might be able to perform like linear algebraic tasks in time that's like polylogarithmic in the dimension. So you have like an n by n matrix, and then it's solving your linear algebra problem in like time log n, maybe to like the fifth power or something. And this seems really good because, you know, if you have your classical algorithms and if you have your classical computers, your normal computers that exist today, and you try to do these linear algebra tasks, they take polynomial time. And so the question is how we look at these this gap between the quantum and the classical, and whether the speed up can actually be realized in practice in the sense of like, what's the actual speed up that's going on here? Okay, so quantum computers are like a generalization of classical computers. So they can do anything that a classical computer can do. And so we don't expect them to be slower, but we might not necessarily expect them to be exponentially faster as the runtimes might suggest. Some of the work I do is to try to analyze this gap. And the naive thing to do is if you have a quantum algorithm and you want to see if it works or if it's faster than the classical algorithm, what do? You test it, right? But obviously, we don't have quantum computers right now. The quantum computers we have are like little baby ones that can't do anything, anything close to what we need for running these algorithms. So what we have to do is we have to turn to theoreticians and see what they have to say. And the best case scenario here is that you design a quantum algorithm and it solves a problem that classical people have already studied, and it does it much faster. So the most famous example is Shor's algorithm that can factor numbers in time exponentially faster than any known classical algorithm. Now, we can't necessarily prove that this is exponentially faster, like that no classical algorithm can do, can factor numbers in polynomial time, namely because this would violate P versus NP type stuff. I guess exactly P equals NP. Or P not equal to NP. So we don't know how to do that kind of stuff. And so instead, we just have to see like, okay, classical researchers have studied this for a long time and haven't been able to do anything. And so this is pretty good evidence that quantum algorithms can probably do something. However, this is like a very ideal setting. A lot of quantum algorithms don't actually solve a problem that classical researchers have studied. Usually they solve some like weird variant where they sort of change the problem to try to utilize the quantum computer and then exploit some advantage there. And so the resulting problem is not one that classical researchers have studied. It's just a different, slightly different problem, and then they can get faster than the classical algorithm can get on the original problem. So the stuff that we do, the stuff that we do is develop classical algorithms for this, like these like quantum-ish variants, and try to understand actually how much easier is it to solve than your original classical problem. And sometimes it's much easier. It's a much easier variant. So you can actually have the case where your original classical problem runs in polynomial time, your quantum algorithm solves a different problem in logarithmic time, and then the classical algorithm can solve basically that also in like polylogarithmic time. And that's what this work is doing. Okay. So I want to talk about our result, but it's a little, I don't necessarily want to have to explain how quantum computers work. However, I'll give a short primer. And I guess this is like the most important slide. Like if you want to take anything away, it should probably be this, because I mean, my results are cool, but if you have the intuition for quantum computers, you can like hopefully have some better idea about what's going on in quantum computers, maybe understand a little bit more about what quantum people say when you talk to them at conferences and such. Okay, so the way that you should think about quantum computers is that they're a way of acting on quantum states, which you should think of as negative probability distributions, but allowing for negative probabilities. So what do I mean by this? Focus your attention to like the left side of my slide. Here, I'm going to look at probability distributions over n-bit strings, and I'm going to associate with that a vector of probabilities. So here, I'm going to say that a vector that's like length 2 to the n defines a corresponding random variable, a random n-bit string, if its entries sum to 1. So it's like all the entries are non-negative and sum to 1, then you could see how there's an associated distribution there, right? So here I've defined p to be this vector, and then I'll define box p to be the corresponding random variable. Or if I like look at it, it is 0, 0 with probability 1/2, and like 0, 1, and so on. And the probabilities are the entries of the vector. And you can imagine performing some action on this box P. So for example, I could look at it and I could say, flip the second bit condition on the first bit. I could perform a CNOT gate. And that would be corresponding to applying this matrix to my probability vector P. And so this is how you act on these vectors P, or I guess these like distributions. And if you are aware of like Markov chains, this is exactly, I'm just defining like transition matrices and stuff. This is like the sort of model here. And so the quantum analog is if you have a vector whose Euclidean norm is 1. So they're squares, they sum up, and they're equal to 1. And this is associated to a quantum state. And this quantum state, if you look at it, it has the exact same properties as the original probability distribution, which is that basically what happens is when you look at it, you see your bits with probability corresponding to the entries of the vector, this time squared. But you can still apply actions for the quantum state. You can still apply actions, let's say like you don't look at it, but you still apply the CNOT gate. And that way you can sort of maintain what they call superposition, which is basically like you can have things like negative values in your vector and still manipulate them without actually collapsing it to something that looks like a probability distribution. Anyways, what I'm saying is like, you should think about these Vs as basically being like these probability vector, these box Ps. I'm calling this state here, the quantum state, ket V. That's the name for this. It's a ket, a ket. So in summary, basically, what I said is that the nice thing, the advantage of like working with quantum states as opposed to classical probability distributions is that you can have some negative probabilities and these can cancel. Physicists call this interference. And then if you observe it, it collapses into a classical probability distribution. And one thing to note is that seeing this gives you very little information. Seeing a quantum state corresponding to V is kind of like seeing a probability vector corresponding to V. And it tells you, basically this tells you very little about V, right? If I see this zero, this bit, these two bits with the corresponding probabilities, it tells me very little about what P actually is. But with enough of these samples, I can learn something. So this is like the setup for the algorithm. And so the problem that the quantum algorithm and then our work solves is this problem of solving linear systems, which is the idea that we have a system of linear equations, AX equals B, A is a matrix, X and B are the vectors. And we're given A and B and we want to find X. And we have an additional assumption that A is rank K. You need some kind of assumption if you want to run a quantum algorithm. I want to make sure we can get to questions. I'm going to go a little faster here. But basically, these quantum algorithms, what they do is that they start with copies of these states corresponding to these vectors or these like matrices also. I haven't defined this, but it's defined the quantum state corresponding to a matrix. But there's something similar you can say. And then giving this as input, the quantum algorithm can output a quantum state corresponding to X. And what we do is we basically do the same thing, but in the classical world. And so the prior classical algorithm does a similar thing. It uses the same data structure as the quantum algorithm uses. And then it uses this to get copies of the classical versions, and then it outputs a classical version of this output. And we get the same thing, but just faster. And the thing is, if you look at these runtimes, right, the reason why these algorithms are so appealing is because they get time polylogarithmic in dimension. And also these other exponents are nice too. But the thing is, we get very little information about our output vector. But that still doesn't mean that there's no speed up there. It just means you have to maybe try harder. Okay. I'm not gonna go over the quantum the sort of quantum landscape, but if you want, you can ask me questions about it after. Thanks.
Let's thank Ewin and let's thank all of our speakers today for giving such great talks. Thank you all. All right, we've got about 1 minute, so I'm gonna take the one question we got in chat before the live stream ends, and then if folks have other questions, feel free to stick around and ask afterward. So the one question in chat is for Swati. Swati, can you give an example application of SDPs to give a little bit more intuition for the semi-definite requirement?
Yeah, hi Remy, thanks for the question. So here's an example. You consider just the max cut problem formulation. Remember the problem is you have a graph and you wish to assign to each node xi of your graph the value either +1 or -1 while wanting to maximize, you know, the sum over all ij, wij times 1 minus xi xj. Like you can formulate the max cut problem in that way because the wij represents the weight of the adjoining nodes I and j, and you know you have a +1 when xi and xj have different signs when they are on, like, yeah, when there's a cut. But because you have this product of two variables, it's not a convex problem. And also because you wish to assign integer values to these variables, that's also a difficulty. So the way you get around this is you take this product xi times xj and you replace it with a matrix variable y subscript ij, and then you work with it. And by construction itself, you can prove that Y is a positive semi-definite matrix, and you can relax this original combinatorial problem into this SDP. And in fact, most combinatorial problems that come from graph theory, the reason they become, I mean, a lot of them can be relaxed to be SDPs is because you have this some sort of joint condition on two nodes, like in, for example, in the case of coloring. And then that product is usually, because it's a quadratic thing, it can be made into an SDP. So that's where it comes from. And that's why linearity doesn't suffice.
Thanks, Swati. Since we got two more questions in chat, I will just pick one of them for Ewin before the live stream ends. So Ewin, I'm going to pick Josh's question. So you had amplitudes that were positive and negative, but not complex. Was that a simplification just for ease of explanation, or does your algorithm not need imaginary amplitudes? And can you perhaps remind us what complex and imaginary amplitudes are as you're explaining that?
So the way I describe quantum states is I define them only for, I guess, real numbers. I describe the amplitudes as having only real numbers. But in theory, you could have complex numbers as well. And instead of squaring the numbers to get the probabilities, you sort of take the magnitude first and then you square. Basically, I'm saying that interference can also have, you can also have like complex interference or something like this. So you don't need the amplitudes to be real or to have imaginary elements generally. Like all quantum algorithms can be written in a way that doesn't use any complex amplitudes. It was just a simplification, but it doesn't necessarily matter. I guess my algorithm is classical, so it doesn't need any amplitudes at all. It's a zero qubit algorithm.
All right. Thank you, everyone, for attending this week's colloquium. And thank you again to our speakers for telling all of us about theoretical computer science.